nothing we do could ever change what he did that day. When love came running like a river, and we got washed in the water. It's been his said before a giver. Yesterday to today was very jarring. But it's spring in Alberta. What can you do? Well, we want to remind you that in 2 weeks is a highway cleanup. We see that there's some people have already signed up for that. You are welcome to do that. Again, we will start on some May 1st, Saturday. Two shifts, 8:30 and 10:30 and 9:30 to 11:30. You can sign up for both or one or the other. There's going to be snacks before and after. And if you have kids, that's what's keeping you from doing highway cleanup, we will do childcare here at church. I will be doing that, and Jane has offered to help me. So that sign-up is there, and so hopefully we can get a good group, and we won't take us long to clean up. I was very interested, this is just an aside, when I did it last year, that the majority of things we picked out of the ditches were Tim's cups. So Tim's folks, who eat Tim's, evidently throw their stuff out the window and not put it in the trash, as opposed to Starbucks people. Just saying. That's what my very bad kind of look survey of the thing. Just if you have kids this morning that are in kids ministry, they did wonderful last week. Just remember that you have a separate sign-in at the front door for them, separate registration for kids. And then when you go to pick them up, you pick them up where you drop them off and then make a circle or out into the other door so there's not a big jam in front. So we're excited that we're doing a children's ministry again and that things are going well. This morning, we're going to look at the last chapter of the book of John and see where Jesus shows up in the midst of the ordinary events of at least the disciples' life in the days and weeks after the resurrection, joining them in their work, eating with them, and then just the friendship that they shared, that Jesus shared with the disciples. So the question I want you to ponder throughout this morning, because I want to be able to share together at the end of my sermon this morning, is where have you seen Jesus show up in the ordinary activities of your days and weeks during this last year? So that's a question I want you to ponder, and then we'll have time to do some sharing at the end of my sermon this morning, that we can share with each other where you have seen Jesus show up. I think sometimes, I don't know about you, but I feel like my focus has narrowed as my world has narrowed during this last year, and sometimes we don't always have eyes to see where Jesus is and where Jesus is working in our life. So just ponder that this morning, and hopefully we'll have a number of you who would like to share where you have seen Jesus show up in your life. But God is here in the midst of us, the one who brought his son back from the dead. We celebrate that this morning as we continue in the season of Easter. So let us stand and worship God together.
Desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished. Written, Jesus. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? God of ages, step down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ.
You are our hope. You are our purpose. And we thank you and praise you for all that you have done for us, for the small little reminders that you love us, to the very, very big reminders. Enter this place, Lord. Let this praise and worship time be a beautiful incense to you. We need you every day. Come be with us today. Amen.
Bowing here.
runs deep. Your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand or fall on you, Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand or fall on you, Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. We need him greatly, don't we? This is a verse that has been on my heart a lot lately, Matthew 11, 28 to 30. Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. How many of you need rest for your weary soul? It's not an easy time that we're living through. But if we are focused on him, he makes the big things not so big sometimes. We still have to deal with them, but he will help us and he will make a way.
Darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. Never stop, never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. That is who you are.
Let's pray together. Lord God, as we have just sung, you are here in our midst. I don't know what each person here this morning needs to hear from you, but you do. So I pray that your Spirit would work through the words you have given me and through the words of your amazing word, that each of us would receive through your Spirit what we need to hear this morning. Whether we are lonely or tired or anxious or worried or filled with life and excited about what you are doing in us, wherever we are, God, on our journey of faith this morning, speak to us from your word. In your name we pray. Amen. One of the first pilgrims to visit the Holy Land and then record her experiences was a woman named Egeria. Little is known about her, except that she lived in the 4th century. And she had traveled all the way from the Atlantic coast of Europe to the Holy Land and spent 3 years visiting and seeing all there was to see in that part of the world. Not only would her journey have been difficult, but as a woman, I imagined it was also fraught with danger. But when she arrived, she began to visit monasteries and holy sites. And then when she got to Jerusalem, it was in the Lenten and Easter season when she was able to take part in all the pageantry that was part of Christian life in Jerusalem. And from her writing, we have a record of those ancient liturgies, those liturgical practices that were present in the early years of the church. She eventually found her way up to Galilee, specifically the northern shore of the Sea of Galilee, where it was thought that Jesus' feeding miracles had occurred. There on the north shore of the Sea of Galilee, she visited a small Byzantine church that had been erected, and an altar had been built over where they thought, where Jesus met with his disciples over a charcoal fire, and they shared a meal together. That location of that ancient church isn't on most Christian itinerary when they visit the Holy Land. It isn't big and flashy like the Church of the Holy Sepulchre or the Church of the Nativity or the Dome of the Rock. But in that small church on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, something ordinary is celebrated, a breakfast that Jesus ate with his disciples. It was in that ordinary activity, not just of that meal, but the fishing that had gone on before that meal, and Jesus being with his friends, spending time with uncertain disciples, and then recommissioning them for the tasks that lie ahead. It's amazing how the simple everyday activities can have such a lasting impact, even 2,000 years after they happened. Satisfying work, a simple meal eaten with friends, can remind us that in the ordinary events of our life, in the ordinary day-to-day functioning of our life, can catch in those everyday events, in those ordinary activities of our day, we can catch a glimpse of Jesus. If we have eyes to see and hearts that are open to witness what Jesus is doing in us and through us and to us, and then discover the blessings that come as we meet Jesus. So turn with me in your Bible as we read in this last chapter of the Gospel of John, and read about these ordinary things, these ordinary activities that Jesus was a part of. It's on the screen as well this morning. Afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way: Simon Peter, Thomas, also known as Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. "I'm going to fish," Simon Peter told them, and they said, "We'll go with you." So they went out and got into the boat, and that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was him, and so they called out to him. He called out to them, "Friends, have you any fish?" "No," they answered, and he said, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." As soon as Simon Peter heard it, he said, "It is the Lord." He wrapped an outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from the shore, about 100 yards. And when they landed, they saw fire burning coals there with fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have caught." Simon Peter climbed aboard and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153, but even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus had appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. The weather, despite what it looks like outside today, has become spring. At least yesterday, we had a good look at it before the snow came. Plants are pushing their way up out of the dirt. Some of the leaves have begun to bud, and some grass, not very much, has begun to green up. But it's easy in the midst of all of our activities of our daily life that we have maybe moved on from the events and celebration of Easter, especially if you've eaten and consumed all the Easter candy that you have purchased. But even if we've moved on from Easter, God is still at work in the world. God is still at work in the ordinary routine of our days. We need to open our eyes and to see the resurrected Jesus and his activity in our work and in the lives of our friends and even in the simple meals that we eat in these days following Easter. Jesus showed up in the lives of his disciples as they were involved in the ordinary work of fishing. As I was pondering this passage this week, I wondered why it was that this group of disciples, these seven disciples, had left Jerusalem in the first place. And why had they headed back to Galilee, to the Sea of Galilee, their old stomping grounds on the shore that had been so familiar to all of them. This would not have been a random decision because it was a four-day journey from Jerusalem to Galilee, and they would have to have prepared and gotten everything they needed to make that trip. They must have realized at some point that there was nothing left for them in Jerusalem, that Jesus was gone, and they're not sure when he was going to come back, and he had left no instructions about what was next. So it seemed that it would be easy to go back to familiar territory, and even more than that, to a familiar task, familiar work, fishing. Now, many of those seven disciples that were there in Galilee had actually come from that area, come from the fishing villages that surrounded the Sea of Galilee, from Bethsaida and Capernaum, that were located around there. In fact, Peter himself was from Bethsaida, which literally means the house of fish. So fishing was in their blood of these seven, most of the seven that came back. Peter tells the group very simply, "I'm going out to fish. I'm going back to a familiar thing. I'm going back to what we knew before we started on this journey with Jesus." And so they go and they take their boats with their nets and they head out in the evening to put their nets down to catch fish. Figuring out that maybe by doing this familiar task, they would figure out what was next. And it was fishing out on the water where Jesus finds them in a similar place where he found some of them 3 years before, on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, fishing, where Jesus promises them that now you will be fishing for people. But on this particular morning, as they are finished from their evening of fishing, they have no success. Even after all this work of going out and in their confusion about what they should be about, I wondered if their failure made them anxious. Wondering, if we can't do this thing, this work we have known all of our life, what are we good for? What can we do? So with no fish in their nets, they decide it's we're done, let's pack it in and head back to shore. But there's a man on the shore that they don't really know who it is, who calls to them and says, "Hey, Before you come in, take your nets and put them on the other side of the boat. To unsuccessful fishermen who have been fishing all night, that didn't sound like something probably that they wanted to do. They were tired and discouraged and wondering if fishing was something they could even do anymore. But they do as the man says. They put down their nets on the other side of the boat, and amazingly, their nets become so full of fish that there's just an amazing abundance, a great catch that they have. As before in Jerusalem, the disciples do not necessarily recognize that this person who's giving them fishing instructions, who has done it before, those same fishing instructions, is really Jesus. And I wondered, why is that? They've spent 3 years together. They've seen his resurrected body already. How come they do not know that it is Jesus? They'd all seen him close up. They'd seen the wounds in his hand. Why do they fail to recognize him now? Could it be because they didn't expect to see him there on the shores of the Sea of Galilee? They had left him in Jerusalem. Why would he now be there with them? And even though they didn't recognize him, something about this man, maybe it was the command that he gave to put the nets on the other side of the boat, John recognized that it was Jesus and tells Peter, and Peter in his impetuous self jumps over the side of the boat and swims to shore to greet his friend and his teacher. As the disciples were engaged in the ordinary work of fishing, Jesus appears to them, reminding them that even in those ordinary tasks, Jesus will be with them, ready to bless them with abundance, as he does here. Where has Jesus shown up in your work in this last year? Where has Jesus shown up in the work that you go to, the work at home, because many of us have had to do that? Where has Jesus shown up at school, if you're involved in school in these months of COVID? Did you see him in a difficult task that was successfully accomplished? In a meaningful conversation with a coworker, and finding joy in the midst of a mindless task? Or feeling connected in your 300th Zoom call that you've had? I found joy and saw Jesus with my coworkers here at church. In those first months, it was just Hannah and myself in this whole building. And it was a little lonely, but I was glad that Hannah was there. At least there was another human being I could talk to. We even shared my birthday together by going out and getting some lunch to eat together. But as the situation changed and Brandy came back and Linda came back and Joni came back, it's been great to have an office. Conversations that we do together and have staff meeting where we worship together and study together and do the tasks that need to be done together. I have found Jesus in those who were involved in filming all through at church, but also when we had our little film studio over in the prayer room for Rod and Mackenzie and Jason, who were so much a part of that. I saw Jesus as they used their gifts to keep our church going in those early months. And now I see Jesus taking place in the joy of Jenna and Katrin as they have put together an amazing group of volunteers to begin our children's ministry. Their joy, their excitement about reinvigorating children's ministry has worn off on me, and I'm excited about what Jesus is going to do with our children in that wing. That's where I've seen Jesus in my work this year. How about you? Where has Jesus shown up in your work? Jesus was also present around a fire, a charcoal fire, that they ate together, this meal of bread and fish. I don't know about you, but for me, food is a memory keeper. Food and celebrations centered on food are part of my family DNA. When I was little, I mean, we'd be at my grandma's house. She would can and make her own liverwurst, and often have that that we could smear on Zweibach, and that was just the grossest thing ever. As a child, I thought, oh, that is just awful, and I never had any until I was older and my palate had matured, and I started eating pâté and realized, what was I missing? So now I eat Braunschweiger, which I think here is called liver sausage, and I love that. It's just, I don't know. It reminds me when I eat the liver sausage now, I have memories of being in my grandma's house and watching people smear that on her Zweibach that she would make. And every time I eat Chinese food, I think of my mom, because that was a birthday celebration. Many of us chose to have her cook for us. It would take her all day to chop up everything and cook, but it was a fabulous meal. And every time, especially, I eat egg foo young, because that was something she would make as a more everyday kind of meal for us, I think of my mom. And we have a family celebration, too, that we call a Schmeckfest, and really, loosely translated, means taste feast. And it's little plates of good food that we put out for all of us to kind of eat and casually talk with one another. And that's how we do Christmas, and it's become kind of a part of our life together. But food memories remind us of a time or a place or a season or a in our life, and maybe even, as for me, it was a person that we love or an event that has been meaningful to us. The same was true for the disciples. If you remember Luke's passage about the Emmaus Road, that Jesus had walked hours with two of his disciples and they didn't know it was him as they spent all this time walking. But it was when they got to Emmaus and to the house and Jesus took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to them, then the light went off. Then they knew it was Jesus. And here in John 21, Jesus says, come and have breakfast. In that moment, as they ate together around the fire, John tells us, then they knew it was the Lord. If they had an inkling that he was the one on the shore giving them fishing directions, it all kind of gelled as they sat around that fire and eating grilled fish and bread together. And I wondered, as they broke bread and as they ate fish that they had just caught over that charcoal fire, did they also remember other meals with Jesus? Meals eaten on the road as they traveled together. A meal that they ate at Peter's house, not very far from where they were. Meals eaten with tax collectors and prostitutes. A meal eaten in a Pharisee's house. The feeding of 5,000, this huge feeding event, where Jesus took 5 loaves and fish, reminiscent of where he is on this chapter, and feeds 5,000 people with it. And the abundance we see with the amount of fish in our passage happens in the feeding of the 5,000. If you remember that after everybody gets fed, there's still 12 baskets of leftovers. Meals and abundance is something that Jesus is known for. And then there was the sacramental last meal that they shared with Jesus before he was killed. Around that charcoal fire, eating fish and bread, Jesus helped them to see that even in the simplest of meals, a shared Passover meal, the breaking of bread or roasting fish on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, that even in those simple meals, Jesus will continue to be with them, even when he is gone from their midst. Around that fire, as they ate together, and Jesus healed memories of fear, of failure, as they abandoned Jesus in those hours before his death, of denial of being Jesus' friend. Around that fire, Jesus, in a sense, has a sacramental meal. And he rewrites their story, and in particular, he rewrites Peter's story. If you remember the last time that Peter was standing or sitting before a charcoal fire, it was before Jesus was killed. Around another charcoal fire in Jerusalem, Peter denies even knowing Jesus. But here, around this charcoal fire, Jesus reviews old memories, heals Peter's broken story, and gives him a new story. Where in this new story that Jesus tells Peter, he will now become the good shepherd of the flock. He will now become the one who will shepherd the new church that will happen after Pentecost. We all have memories of meals with friends or family, a meal where we recognize the presence of Jesus, a meal where old hurts were healed, where new friendships were created, a meal where the grace and love of Jesus was evident in every dish that was served and every word that was spoken. A couple times this year, I've been able to, in the brief little pockets of time when things have been a little looser, have been able to recognize the presence of Jesus when I had people to my house to have dinner. And when I've cooked meals for a neighbor and people here at church, on those occasions, for me, I recognize the presence of Jesus in fellowship and friendships around a table and the joy of Jesus for me as I cooked for others. Friends, including in that seven were his inner circle, James and John and Peter, who were the first to be called and always, maybe for that reason, were always very close together and kind of Jesus' inner circle. And after 3 years of traveling together all over Israel, eating together, learning together, experiencing life together, I find it comforting that in this moment of indecision and uncertainty, they wanted to be with each other. That with that group together, now I don't know what happened to the other five, why they didn't come, but for these seven, they were found common ground in this time of transition and uncertainty. And isn't that how we find who our lasting friends are? Those people who join us on life's journey, who hang around for the good and the bad, who share our burdens and celebrate our joys,
These friends of Jesus had been together for the worst time, not only in Jesus' life, but for theirs. They knew how they had failed Jesus. They knew how they had abandoned him. And yet Jesus continues to show up to be with them. He doesn't blame them for that. He doesn't call them that, you know, you are not great friends, that you didn't do that to us, that you didn't show up when I needed you. They shared the burden of that failure, and they also were with Jesus in those last hours before he died. But you know what? They were the ones to whom Jesus came the first to show that he was resurrected. There was no blame, only joy in the midst of celebrating his resurrection together. These friends shared an understanding about the kingdom of God, and Jesus had blessed them, as we looked at last week, with the breath of the Holy Spirit, commissioning them, all of them, to be part of the work, the kingdom work that was still ahead. They weren't done. And if we read at the end of Matthew in chapter 28 and Luke in chapter 24, we see the mission that Jesus is giving to these friends, these disciples, a mission to share the good news of Jesus with the world and to teach people about who Jesus was and what he was about, and then to baptize them in his name. And on the day of Pentecost, these friends would become teachers and leaders of the new Christian community that will become the church. They will recreate the powerful signs of Jesus and in his name bring new believers into the community of faith. Jesus gave the task of leadership specifically to Peter, but it was all of those friends gathered that day, and even all 12 who will gather, as we read in Matthew and Luke, at when Jesus leaves this earth, who will play a role together as they gather new believers in Jesus' name and begin to build the church. They will do as Jesus called them to do, as friends, familiar people to one another, to carry on his ministry, empowered by the Holy Spirit, who will inspire and equip and be present with them wherever in the world that the Spirit will lead them. And we know for some of them, they went really broadly to share the message of Jesus. I have been blessed by many of you this past year, and I have experienced Jesus in the ways that you have blessed me, especially the presence of Jesus. When I have received gift baskets from the Stoltzes and the Cruises and the Stortys, they came to my door and offered me a wonderful gift. And I got a gift of a few days off after many months of challenging work with Diane Barrett out at the lake, which was very life-giving for me. And every Friday since last year in March, I've walked every day with Peter Ascott in the initial park because he had lost his favorite dog, Sadie, and I offered my dog to him as a grief therapy dog. But my dog looks forward to those walks as much as I do. The minute I turn down Peter's street, she begins to whine incessantly in the back of the car. She knows what's coming, and she is grateful for that. If dogs can understand the presence of Jesus, my dog does, because she really looks forward to being with her friend Peter and walking with him. And in these gifts of Jesus that I have received from you, I have been strengthened and encouraged to do what God has called me to do in your mix. Work that through this last year has often challenged me and not always been easy for me, but the presence of Jesus that I have seen through you has been a blessing to me. So as I said before we started this morning, where have you seen Jesus in your life? Have you seen him in your work, in meals shared with others, or in the relationships with your friends during this COVID year? Where have you seen, maybe more broadly, where have you seen Jesus in unexpected places this year? So hopefully you've thought about that and would like to share that. I will take the mic around if you would like to share where you have seen the presence of Jesus this year in the ordinary events of your life.
very blessed to work with Jordy Praker every day, and the grace that he gives when I make a mistake, I mean, is pure Jesus. He just hands everything out and so generous for everyone around, despite the challenges that he and his friends are going through in this difficult time. He is more interested in how his friends are doing than in how he is doing.
Wonderful, thank you. I guess I should have held that for you. Whoops. Yeah. I'll just hold that if that's okay.
I have the gift of gardening that the good Lord has given us. And in that gardening, I have found little things to bring joy not only to myself, but whoever comes past our garden. And this week, for some reason, I was inspired to make a walking beer man in my garden on top of a tree. And it can be seen from the edge of the park. And it's just something to chuckle about. And yet, why that appeared to me at night, I have no idea. So creatively, the saw went to work, and I've been so blessed to have be able to bring some glimmer of joy to other people out of my gardens.
Thank you.
Linda and I are so happy that the good Lord showed up and gave us some work to do. If we had to do a renovation on a house, and it helped us all through the fall and up into Christmas instead of sitting and doing nothing. And also, he shows up lately in every sunrise and every sunset.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I have been involved with John Vanderlaan and a care group that texts back and forth for a long time. And it's been 3 years since this all began with his cancer and his surgeries. And it's 2 weeks ago, he was sitting over there and shared communion with us. And whoops, I lost it. No, I didn't. And just this week, it's been a real bad situation for him. He says, I feel like I am trapped in an awake nightmare. I could have a better intelligent conversation with a randomly selected person off the psych ward than with this oncologist. This whole episode is insane. Get out of there. If I had hair, I would pull it out because this is so frustrating. If you want to pray for me, then pray that I manage to hang on to the faith of Abraham and wait for God to take me to the new heavenly city where there are no oncologists. So it's been a privilege to be a part of this group that texts back and forth and gives John the encouragement that he needs, and for him to just pour out his heart on all of us and have us share in the joys and in the grief and the difficulties that he's faced with. And I just feel I've felt it's a really privilege to be a part of that group and to share with him and to pray for him. And so I'd ask all of us, pray for John and Judy as they go through this, another episode, another difficulty in their lives. Thank you.
I mean, I have so much to share about God's presence in my life, and Jane has we have a deaf son. And he's been really quite angry at me specifically because I haven't learned sign language. And I've just been patient, and he's been patient, and God put it on his heart from Montreal to put us on Zoom And he is teaching us every Sunday afternoon sign language. So I am getting that.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
I appreciate what I'm able to, where I'm able to be over at the, at Sagewood and Wheatland Lodge. We just, God is so good in bringing people into my life. And it's so interesting. I'm encouraged as I leave that second floor of Sagewood. And the other day I couldn't go up there, so I went down where Meredith is in, on the first floor, and they just love my coming there, and I just really enjoy their fellowship. And then a friend of mine, he just died recently, and he was there, in Floyd is his name, and I just enjoyed his fellowship, and I really miss him, First Nations man, just love the Lord, and I would read in the scriptures, and I read this verse, for God so loved Floyd, yellow fly, and he says, write that down in this Bible, and he told me about this Bible. He got it from a motel somewhere. He took it, and I said, You have my blessing in taking it. That's all right. And he wrote this down in there, and he would tell me to read it again. And I know he's with the Lord.
Yeah, I was just thinking, this Christmas, Chuck and I were alone for the first time in a long time. I don't know whether we've ever been alone for Christmas, but just a day or so before Christmas, I get a text, and it's from the Peterson family. They'd been out skating near our home, and they said, "Come out on your front deck, and we're gonna sing some Christmas carols." And that was very special that they thought of us and swung by and shared that with us. That was Jesus showing up for me that day. That was special.
That's great. Well, even if you didn't feel like sharing, maybe this would be a good kind of jolt to you to think about those places where Jesus has shown up, and those ordinary places, as many of you have shared, in your life. Because that's what Jesus did in our passage this morning, that in the work of fishing and sharing food around a charcoal fire and being with his friends and fellowshipping with them and healing their pain, reminds us of the reality of the resurrection, that we live in the midst of that all the time, and that we are called, as the disciples are called, to carry on Jesus' work, even in the midst of the ordinary events of our lives. So keep your eyes open. Look for Jesus, for his presence, because I guarantee he will show up in the least expected ways, in unexpected places, because he comes to make all things new. And he wants to do that in our lives. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you that you are a God who never leaves us, that your presence is always with us in the midst of the ordinary events of our lives. Sometimes it's easy to miss your presence because we're so busy and our head is down and our blinders are on and we just want to get through what we're in the midst of, and we don't look to see how you desire to come into our life and make all things new. So open our eyes, open our hearts. May your spirit prod us
in those moments that we need to see you. And we have heard different ways in which these in our congregation have seen you. And we lift up the situations that were even brought to mind this morning for John and Judy, for Floyd. God, in those are not ordinary experiences that either one has gone through, but God, you were in the midst of that and are continuing to be with Judy and John in the midst of their journey. We thank you for friends that come alongside and maybe prompt us, remind us of your presence with us. So God, as we continue to live in these challenging days, help us to see you. And then when we do, may that bring us joy, even in the midst of the challenge. May it give us strength and courage to continue on this path that we're all on. We share that together. I think that's one of the things that Jesus points out with his friends, that we as a church body, as a world, we are all going through this together. May when we see Jesus, may we share that with someone else who needs to know that and see where Jesus is. Because a resurrected Jesus is always with us, giving us power and hope and strength when we need it for the walking through these days. So in the name of our resurrected Lord, we give you thanks and praise for Jesus and all that he continues to do in and through our lives. Amen.
Please stand with us.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul, worship his holy. Unending.
Have not seen and still believe. So may you go out into your week and give thanks for the Jesus that you do not see, but who is in every part of your life. Have eyes that are open to see him everywhere. Amen. Thank you.